Let's now look at the goals of modern cryptography. Modern cryptography started in 1950s, and even here there is a history, but as we go through this course, we will understand the evolution gradually. As I mentioned earlier, classical cryptography just focused on confidentiality, whereas modern cryptography handles confidentiality. This it does via symmetric key and asymmetric key algorithms. We will see more of this later. It also handles integrity, not just message integrity, but also source integrity. We often call this authentication. This it does via hashes, max, and digital signatures. Again, these also we will cover in detail later. Modern cryptography is also used for currency purposes, e-voting, providing anonymity, so on. There are a lot of standards that cater to this confidentiality and integrity. DES, which stands for Data Encryption Standard, and AES, which stands for Advanced Encryption Standard, are popular symmetric key algorithms. These are used for encryption and MAC. MAC is nothing but one that provides authentication. RSA is a popular public key algorithm. This is used for encryption as well as digital signatures. Again, digital signatures provide integrity as well as authentication. DSA is another digital signature algorithm, which is a public key algorithm. This cannot be used for encryption, but it works for digital signatures. There are many popular hash functions, SHA-1, SHA-2, SHA-3, MD4, MD5, but only SHA-2 and this SHA-3 are safe currently. The others are broken. Before we dig into the actual mechanisms of how confidentiality and integrity are provided, it is good to understand the basic building blocks behind these algorithms. So let's look at these as well under background. So the first building block we will look at is what is called confusion and diffusion. This is the foundation of symmetric key algorithms, which in turn are used to provide confidentiality and integrity and authentication. What does confusion mean? We have actually already seen this. This is a way to transfer information in plain text so that it is not easy to extract. So one way you can achieve confusion is via substitution. So you're changing T to S, H to B, E, L. That way a given word is no more identifiable as that particular word. So you're hiding the plain text symbols. Diffusion is about spreading information from a region of plain text much wider in the ciphertext. This is nothing but transposition. So you're moving around, the shuffling the plain text so that again it is not obvious as to what the plain text is. Symmetric ciphers use a combination of both confusion and diffusion. We will see exactly how in the later lectures. The second building block that is extensively used in cryptography are one-way functions. These form the foundation of hashes, which provide message integrity. These are also the foundation of asymmetric key algorithms, which provide confidentiality and integrity and authentication. This confidentiality we are calling encryption. This integrity and authentication as provided by asymmetric key algorithms are also called digital signatures. While previously MAC that we said, this also provides integrity and authentication, but these are based on symmetric key algorithms. So what are one-way functions? These are functions that are easy to compute but difficult to invert. So this is the foundation of hashes. The same one-way functions but with something called a trapdoor are the foundations of asymmetric key algorithm. Here it is easy to compute and it is easy to invert only provided you have a key. Without the key, it is difficult to invert. So this example illustrates the point. If you have two large prime numbers P1 and P2, it's very easy to multiply them. But if you give the product, it is very difficult to factor them out and determine the individual prime numbers. But if you know P1 already and the product, it is easy to determine what P2 is. So the trapdoor in this case is knowledge of P1. This is a simple example, but things are a little bit more complex in real life. So let's dig in a little bit more. So for this, we need to understand computational complexity. If you are a CS student, this is something you should be familiar with by now. But let me just give a high-level overview. So we typically classify algorithms based on the time and space complexity. Let's focus on time complexity. If n is the input to the algorithm and it is doing some job and it takes this much time for it to finish this job, we say the time complexity is order n square. So there are different classes of algorithms. An algorithm that does a job independent of n, it takes just constant time, we call it order 1. If it is taking time, which is n to the power of m, where m is a constant, we call it a polynomial time algorithm. And if it takes time, that is c raised to the power of a function of n, where fn is a polynomial function of n, we call the algorithm to be exponentially complex. Now, a given problem, there could be multiple algorithms to solve this particular problem, and each algorithm may take different time. But it is useful to characterize the complexity of a problem itself. So for this, typically we try to determine what is the minimum time it will take to solve this problem on something called a Turing machine. So this machine has finite state, but it has infinite read-write memory. I won't get into too much detail. If you want to know more about it, read it up by yourself. There is also something called non-deterministic Turing machine. This is a machine that can make guesses and then can check whether the guess is right in polynomial time. This guess is nothing but a solution to the particular problem. So these classes of problems are again can be divided into P and NP. P means it is solvable in polynomial time. For example, if sorting a list is something that is solvable in polynomial time. For these, verifying a solution is also polynomial. For NP problems, these problems are solvable in polynomial time, but this is on a non-deterministic Turing machine. An example of an NP problem is a traveling salesman's problem. Let me emphasize, finding a solution to this problem may not be polynomial, but verifying the solution is polynomial. When we say NP, the polynomial comes if the machine can guess the solution or try all the guesses in parallel. But in reality, for you to try all the guesses in parallel, it may turn out to be non-polynomial. So within non-polynomial time problems, there is a set called NP-complete. These are the hardest problems. If any NP-complete problem can be solved in polynomial time, what this means that every problem in NP can also be solved. Similarly, EXP are problems that are solvable in exponential time. For these, verifying solution may or may not be polynomial. So this is how we represent this. There are class of problems that are polynomial. Then there are problems that are non-polynomial. And then there are exponential class of polynomials. Whether P is equal to NP, you must have heard about this. This is an open question. Enough of complexity. You must be wondering, what does all this mean to cryptography? So let's talk about that. For now, let's just focus on encryption because it's easy to illustrate. So to achieve encryption, so you have this message, you're converting it into ciphertext. This side is polynomial. In other words, converting the message to ciphertext takes only polynomial time. For an attacker to get back the plain text from the ciphertext, he has to solve an NP-complete problem. So this direction is non-polynomial. Because these NP problems are very difficult to solve, attacker often cannot solve them and thereby cannot recover the plain text from the ciphertext. So some examples of these NP-complete problems are integer factorization, where you have to find the prime factors of a given number n, or discrete logarithm. For example, you have to find x where a to the power of x is equal to b. It seems simple, but we are dealing with very large numbers which are made up of thousands of bits. So for such large numbers, this is not easy at all. Naturally, the receiver should be able to decrypt. So these functions always have a trapdoor. If you have the trapdoor, recovering the plain text from the ciphertext will turn out to be polynomial. So all this is kind of captured with these equations. So fmk to the ciphertext is polynomial. Inverting this function without the key, as you saw there is no key here, is non-polynomial. But if you have the key, this inversion can be achieved in polynomial time. Recently, there is focus on something called elliptic curve cryptography. This is a form of asymmetric key algorithm. So this deals with a problem that is even tougher than integer factorization problem that I talked about there. So this problem is called ECDLP, which basically stands for elliptical curve discrete logarithmic problem, where it leverages the difficulty of computing the discrete logarithm of a random elliptic curve over some finite field. If you didn't understand, you're not alone. Neither do I understand the math behind this. It's pretty complex. This is just to give you an indication that there is a lot of beautiful math that is used in cryptography to make the life of the attacker difficult. So one big advantage of elliptic curve cryptography is that it works with smaller key sizes than RSA, thereby it is much faster to compute. For example, a 256-bit elliptic curve cryptography provides comparable security as a 3072-bit RSA, which is based on integer factorization problem. Quantum cryptography is another hot thing that is receiving more attention these days. This exploits the uncertainty of the quantum world. If you must have heard of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, so this is based on this. Again, I'm not going to get into the detail, except that this can be used to generate a secret key. The beautiful thing about this is even if an attacker had unlimited power, or tomorrow it is shown that P is equal to NP, with quantum cryptography, eavesdropping is still impossible, because the moment you eavesdrop, it will disrupt the transmission and both endpoints can get to know that someone is eavesdropping. The very nature of the solution makes eavesdropping impossible. So by the way, I have not mentioned that this is used for encryption, that it is used to generate a secret key. So somehow, if two parties A, B are able to generate a secret key, which is the same across both of them, after this point, you can use symmetric key algorithms to communicate with each other. So this generation of a secret key is a hard problem, and that is what this quantum cryptography is solving. So to summarize, modern cryptography is a lot more rigorous and it can achieve a lot more than classical cryptography. So it can provide confidentiality, integrity, anonymity, e-voting, digital cash, so on. So this it does via symmetric key, asymmetric key algorithms and hashes. The underlying mechanisms behind these algorithms are confusion and diffusion. So this is applicable for symmetric key algorithms, and one-way functions, this is applicable for asymmetric key algorithms and hashes. And these one-way functions are based on computationally hard NP-complete problems, where the forward direction function is polynomial, whereas inverting the function is non-polynomial, but with a key, it is polynomial. That is what we call the trapdoor.